Philip, what are you doing right now for the camera, please?
I am cutting out badges, these guys, so that people can slip them in behind their badge holders. So MIT alums and people affiliated with MIT.
So yeah. One of these, perhaps.
Yeah, one of those.
Well, yes, that's like very good. Thank you.
It wasn't planted at all.
Yeah.
Unfortunately,
kind of.
I think it's the best use for the GDC program that I've seen so far.
Yeah. Well, you can beat people with it. It's pretty heavy.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's my understanding of how the situation went anyway.
That's fantastic. Can I have another sheet over there?
Welcome to this session. My name is Marina Copier, and this session is going to be all about tips and tricks to collaborate with international partners. And of course, the goal of the session is to get this happy together. First of all, I would like to thank Susan for programming this year's summit on the theme of collaboration. I think that collaboration is at the heart of a successful game development and creates not only good games, but also talented and happy people. But collaboration is not always easy. Over the past 3 years, I've been building a lot of collaborations, also with a lot of people here sitting at the table, with universities and companies. All over the world, but learning to speak each other's language can sometimes be a real challenge. And when I say real challenge, a very big challenge.
You know, we've known for a while that big budget industry doesn't like taking risks, right? So that's why you have things like lighting indies, doing the indie stuff. You have social media people doing more interesting stuff on the metagame level. But the weird thing about it was, like, Activision, for instance, firing the two heads of Infinity Ward, you know, the guys who created the Call of Duty series. And it's like, how does that even make sense? I mean, at least respect the fact that these guys make tons of money for the company. By, you know, they don't innovate in the sense of making anything new, but they do really good, polished product. And you're firing them too. So I don't understand how the industry works anymore, really. I mean, it is all about shareholder value. It is all about milking every sequel until it's worth, I guess. But this is not a... This can't possibly be viewed as a sustainable practice by anybody. I mean, even the most jaded CEO. I mean,
we, as an industry, are... There's an abandonment of the auteur, and there isn't much trust in the director, and something that you see other industries do well. They say, here's a person whose name is solid enough that and they've done enough good work that we can trust them to take risk, because we're gonna trust this person who is delivered.
Well, but to some extent, the audience also trusts them to take risk.
Right.
So, like, you can say Sid Meier's Railroad Tycoon, Sid Meier's
Exactly.
Not only is that no trust, it's also the assumption that they're replaceable.
Yeah.
And that's a really weird for me, because I don't think anyone rational can imagine that a really, really good leader who consistently leads a company to make profitable product is easily replaceable in any way.
There's like a forced dissociation too, right? Because there's some people who make things like, you know, Sid Meier's Civilization or whatever, but the games industry is trying really hard to take the author out of the game so that it just becomes, you know, Call of Duty.
Right.
Or to get the publisher associated with it, right? It's like, it's pushed the publisher's name
in
association, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like when we see a Scorsese film, I try to name who the, is it Warner Brothers? Is it Paramount? Like, I don't know, and I don't really care, right? I trust him.
Right.
No, they're still, the publisher's still making the money, though.
Sure, so. I mean, they're making the money anyway.
Yeah.
And in fact, the the person's name give them something to market the game on. In fact, I can imagine having the right person's name on a game helps you sell a game that you may have trouble selling otherwise. Even if it's a good game, especially if it's a new genre, busting game. It's like, how are we going to market this thing? Well, we'll just call it a boring game. And then we'll be able to market it. But I'm thinking like, the real Electronic Arts used to be about the individual games. There used to be like United Artists.
That's why the talk at 145 today is going to be awesome.
Yeah.
So what is this talk about 145?
It's about why industry vets are leaving the mainstream AAA games and headed to social media games like Facebook and Twitter games and stuff like that. And it's going to be heavy hitters. And Steve Moretzky of Hitchhiker's Guide, Text Adventure Games, Brenda Brathwaite of Ultima fame.
Wizardry
fame. Rick Everhart of awesome fame.
So actually, what the hell did you do this morning?
What did I woke up. No, I had some coffee. Then I went to a couple talks. The first one grabbed me because it was about prototyping for engagement and metaphor. And it was interesting. It was one guy talking about his game that he's working on that's about trying to find your lost daughter in a crowd kind of riot scene in a kind of post-democratic Iraq, I think. So that was kind of interesting. And then after that, there was another presentation by a doctor and a game developer who were working on training devices, but in game form for laparoscopy. So they had...
I saw the prototype.
The prototype for the thing with the scissors, with the Wiimotes, was awesome. Then I grabbed some coffee 5 minutes before I was supposed to and got told I shouldn't have gotten coffee at 10:55. And then...
It's too early for coffee,
it's too early.
Man.
And then I watched the first Serious Game Summit keynote speech by Soren Johnson from EA, who works on Civ 4, Civ 3?
Civ 4,
maybe. And he was talking about why theme is not meaning and why mechanic is meaning in games, and how to align your theme and your mechanic in games. And it was good.
It's the most exciting thing about it was that instead of doors being closed to me at this stage, I sort of expected to have my options more limited at that. But what I found was that I found collaborators and like-minded people that were also excited about making stuff outside of the corporate sphere. And so I found collaborators that helped me sort of make graphic novels, feature-length movies, and video games. And I came to realize that we can actually reduce our dependence on corporations by building communities instead. And the communities basically give us the same access to the talented people that companies basically do.